Good evening. My name is Sean Hudgeonwardle, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles, and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5, that there are lords many, and gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name, and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of the Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state he is inscrutable and incomprehensible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walk the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a prayer by Dr. Bud Wunsch. That will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson today will be the first chapter of Ecclesiastes, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser. Dr. Wunsch?
Good evening, everyone. Let's give thanks to our Heavenly Father and His Son, Yahshua the Messiah, that He has seen fit for us to be led here, to hear the only truth that's being taught in this world today. And we are most grateful that you have chosen us from the billions of people that could have been. And we do ask that you continue to show us more of your purpose, pattern, and plan. We ask all of these things in the name of thy only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say.
Hallelujah. search for him while he is near, while he can be found. If you really feared, you would search for him. He's everywhere. Yahweh can be found while there's still time to care.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Our scripture lesson will be taken from Ecclesiastes, the first chapter, page 792, and I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainer, Scripture Research Association, Incorporated. Ecclesiastes, the first chapter. The words of the preacher, the son of David, king of Jerusalem. Vanity of vanities, said the preacher, vanities of vanities, all is vanity. What profit has a man of all his labor which he taketh under the sun? One generation passeth away, and another generation cometh, but the earth abideth forever. The sun also ariseth, and the sun goeth down, and hastened to his place where he arose. The wind goeth towards the south, and turneth about unto the north. It whirleth about continuously, and the wind returneth again according to his circuits. All the rivers run into the sea, yet the sea is not full. Unto the place where whence the rivers come, thither they return again. All things are full of labor. Man cannot utter it. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor the ear filled with hearing. The things that has been, it is that which shall be, and that which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing under the sun. Is there anything whereof it may be said, see, this is new? It hath been already of old time, which was before us. There is no remembrance of former things, neither shall there be any remembrance of things that are to come with those that shall come after. I, the preacher, was king over Israel in Jerusalem, and I gave my heart to seek and search out by wisdom concerning all things that are done under heaven. This sore travail hath Elohim given to the sons of man to be exercised therewith. I have seen all the works that are done under the sun, and behold, all is vanity and vexation of spirit. That which is crooked cannot be made straight, and that which is wanting cannot be numbered. I commune with my own heart, saying, lo, I am come to great estate, and have gotten more wisdom than all they that have been before me in Jerusalem. Yea, my heart had great experience of wisdom and knowledge. And I gave my heart to know wisdom, and to know madness and folly. I perceive that this also is vexation of spirit. For in much wisdom is much grief, and he that increaseth knowledge increaseth sorrow. I have read the first chapter of Ecclesiastes. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Wunsch, and thank you, Dr. Reiser. Today is Thursday, and it is our open testimony night. So, at this time, before I call a speaker, I would like to ask if anybody would like to give a testimony. And if not, then I will call a speaker or a lecture. Testimony or a lecture. Okay. All right. So, for our first speaker, I would like to call Dr. Maria Clemens.
Is that okay to put this over it?
Yeah.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. Thank you for the opportunity to stand before you and to give a reasonable testimony. I've been in this school for a long time, close to 50 years, real close. And I never cease to marvel at the things that Yahweh does, even when things look like they're bad and horrible and the world says, oh, this is the devil doing his work. Well, you know, surprise, you know, it's not the devil. This is Yahweh's work, everything. Right. You know, he said that he was the one from the beginning to the end, and all things good, all things bad, everything. I form the light, I create darkness. I, what's that scripture about? Well, and then he says also that he formed the light and created darkness, but there was the one about he
good and evil,
and he created darkness and and evil.
Isaiah 45:7. I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create evil. I, Yahweh, do all these things.
Yes, that's the one I wanted. And in another Bible, it's a little bit different. Aren't the words different?
But it says punishment.
Punishments. Yeah. So, you know, it's not a devil. It would be a good thing to study this teaching because it explains what the world cannot explain. You know, they believe that God created the devil and just let him have his way on the earth, and then they became enemies, you know, and they're fighting each other. And that's not the way that it is. You know, Yahweh is in control of everything, good and evil, and we need not panic, because when you know that it's him, you don't have to be afraid. You know, I was watching a movie once, and the people were afraid of the big, like the tsunamis and the tornadoes and stuff like that. You know, you see all these disasters. Well, those disasters are not Yahweh's punishment. I mean, unless maybe they are. I don't know. I mean, they could be, because he could do anything he wants. You know, evil people roam the earth, and he could be punishing them. But people, you don't really have to be afraid of those things, because that's Yahweh. The disaster, the tornadoes, the tsunami, all that is Yahweh. You know, he's coming for you. If it's coming, he's coming for you. Don't even be afraid, you know, because before it touches you, you will already be with Yahweh. You know, that's in the scriptures. You know, when you really understand him and know him, it would be like just give yourself, give in. And like Stephen, he was with the Father before the stone touched him. Before the first drop of water touches you, you will be already in heaven, and you don't have anything to worry about. So don't even be afraid. You know, it's a scary thing anyway, because we're human and we have anxieties, you know, and we have faults, and, you know, we're not exactly like Superman, you know, strong and like that. But when you are finally confident that you are a son of Yahweh, there shouldn't be any of that scary stuff, you know, to be afraid of. You don't have to worry about it. I mean, it's a hard thing to say. I mean, I'm going to have to, I guess, it's a word. When it happens to me, I have to be ready to fulfill my words, in other words, you know, what I say, I will be tested, I guess, you know, when the day finally comes. You know, do I really know? I mean, I believe that maybe, because they say that people are afraid to die, you know, and some people say, no, I'm not afraid to die, I'm ready, you know, yeah, God can take me anytime, you know, I already know I got my place in heaven, blah, blah, blah. Well, it's not a guarantee, you know, it is not a guarantee, number one. And number two, you really don't know until you actually get there. When you finally get to that point, then you can say whether, I'm not afraid, I already know, I know Yahweh, and I know I'm his son, or whatever. But until then, we really don't know, you know. So anyway, that's my testimony for today. Thank you so much. God, sorry.
Thank you, Dr. Clemens. So, for our next speaker, I guess I could go a little bit. Yeah. All right. So I'll be the next speaker. Let me set up the mic here. Testing. Yeah, that's good. All right. Thank you again, Dr. Clemens. That was a good testimony. And I like how you had mentioned the stoning of Stephen. And I would like to go to that. If we can go over to Acts 7th chapter, verse 44, starting at 44. And, you know, it's an honor and a privilege to be able to stand before the assembly of the body of Yahshua the Messiah and speak of anything that I've come to know and understand since coming down here to this school or one of these schools, because this is truly the place of the highest learning. And I gotta say, my testimony is that I didn't know anything about my Creator until I came down here and sat in one of these chairs and listened. And I had to listen. I couldn't just be under the sound of this thing and hearing somebody saying something and pointing at a chart. That didn't do it. I had to open up my heart and in my mind, and I had to actually listen to what was being said and meditate on the things that were being taught before I could come to any kind of understanding of that, before Yahweh revealed anything to me about what was being said. I was here for almost 20 years. Not a very proud thing to say when you just start learning about something in the last couple years. You know what I mean? So, it happens in a blink of an eye when you start to get something, but it truly shows the power of Yahweh to be sitting in one of these classes for so long and just not get it. But know that there's something good about the place, but you just don't get it. And you got to get it. Like the founder of the school, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, that we talk about in the moderation, he said that you must remain a skeptic until, you know, you have a profound knowledge of these things. Let's go ahead and read there about the stoning of Stephen. And the reason why I want to pick up at 7:44, because in the moderation, we talk about this tabernacle that we have here. And when we say that everything goes according to the pattern of the tabernacle, and he's talking about that here. So let's go ahead and read.
Our fathers had the tabernacle of witness in the wilderness as he had appointed, speaking unto Moses that he should make it according to the fashion that he had seen, which also our fathers that came after brought in with Joshua the son of Nun to possess the land of the Canaanites.
Right. They had this tabernacle, the fathers, the house of Israel. They were given this tabernacle at this Mount Sinai. Moses went up three times, and on his second trip up onto the mount, he was shown for 33 days in great detail the structure and function of this physical tabernacle, and was told or instructed to build one just like the one that he's seen out here in the wilderness. And he accomplished that. And this is what Stephen is talking about his forefathers had as a witness or as a schoolmaster to the likeness and image of Yahweh, to learn something and know something, to sacrifice their sacrifices to when they broke or transgressed the law. And they followed, they packed this thing up and they followed this cloud that was out here that would sit on this mount, and when that cloud would move, they would pack up this tabernacle and follow the cloud around. Just like your physical body follows your cloud around whenever your consciousness decides that it's time to get up and move, your body or your tabernacle picks up and goes and follows that cloud. Now continue reading, because it speaks on that.
To possess the land of the Canaanites, whom Elohim drove out before the face of our fathers.
Now they said that the fathers and Joshua the son of Nun. Now he highlights Joshua the son of Nun, and in Christendom, they just got Joshua the son of Nun as some old man Nun's son. But what we teach down here in this school is that that's not just Joshua the son of Nun. We, knowing that there was no J, there was no Joshua back in that time in the Hebrew language. There's just no name Joshua. Nobody was named Joshua. This was Yahshua. This was Yahshua, their savior. This was Yahweh. Come down from Yahweh taking on shape and form. Come down from super incorporeal state into a physical fleshly body, walking around with the house of Israel, fighting all of their battles for them, leading them from out of the bondage of Egypt all the way up into Canaan's land, which was the land that was promised to their forefather, Abraham. Mm-hmm. So that's why they talk. That's why Stephen is referring to their fathers and Joshua, the son of Nun, because he's just not just Joshua. Mm-hmm. Joshua being Moses's minister. And a minister is a servant. And he was providing the service of salvation to these Jews at this time. So let's go on. I just wanted to touch on that and kind of get a little bit of detail of the context of why he's talking about Joshua and the fathers and what they had back then as a rule, as something to go by, to know something about their heavenly father, as a measure of righteousness unto them, and a law they had as well. But let's read.
Who found favor before Yahweh and desired to find a tabernacle for the Elohim of Jacob. But Solomon built him a house. Howbeit, the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands, as said the prophet.
The Most High, Yahweh, does not dwell in temples made with hands. So we're talking about Solomon's temple up here. And, you know, you got travel agents making a good pretty penny to this day booking trips over there to look at this temple or go over into this area. And this land is divided. They still fighting. And when you go in here, they got it split in half. They got their enemies feuding with each other. And, you know, you got one faction, the house of Israel, and what is that, Judah on the other side? Israel on one side and Judah on the other side? Is that how it's separated? I get it mixed up sometimes.
That's Ishmael's side.
I know that they got it separated, and I can't remember the two different factions. So, somebody will straighten me out. Mohammed's on one side, and then it's the Israelites on the other side. Okay. Well, I'm gonna go and look that up, because we need to know these things. And next time I get up here and I talk about that, I should know. Anyhow, for certain, but. People go, the point that I'm trying to make across is people go to this physical building looking for a feeling of righteousness, looking for God, looking for an understanding of what God wants them to do with their life, looking for direction, looking for a message. But we'll read that again about how be it.
Who found Howbeit, the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands.
So what you going there for? Where does he dwell?
As said the prophet, heaven is my throne.
Heaven is his throne.
And earth is my footstool.
Earth is his footstool. That's why you got, let's just get it, over in Exodus 24, 9 and 10. And you went, and there's a pictorial illustration of what's kind of described right there. Let's read that real quick.
Exodus 24, 9 and 10.
Mm-hmm.
Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel.
All right. So this is the second trip into the mount that I had mentioned when we got that, when we got this tabernacle. And at the beginning of the first verse here, Moses was instructed to come up into a mount, into the mount alone and by himself. And Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 elders were to come nigh. They weren't supposed to come all the way up into the mount, but they were supposed to come halfway up into the mount, to the plateau. So now they're going up into the mount. Now they're at this plateau all together. Read.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel. They saw this superincorporeal shape and form. Now, it looks on this, because this is a static chart. This is a static pictorial illustration. It's not graphic. You can't move it around or anything like that. So for the sake of understanding, they've got a line showing up here, and they've got one picture of Elohim. But to be honest, they were down here. They seen them down here. They didn't see them up here, and Moses was up here. Moses was down here with them at this time that they're seeing him. Moses was here with them. Joshua, the son of Nun, was here with them. The Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, they were all here together on this plateau, and they seen Joshua. They seen Yahweh Elohim. We just got on this chart looking up here because we don't got room or space on this chart to have Yahweh Elohim down here and then Yahweh Elohim up here, because then it'll cause confusion. You'll be thinking that there's more than one Yahweh Elohim if you got him all over the place. He's a unity. We just use this to show him up here. Now, they didn't see these 70 elders, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, they didn't see the vision that Moses seen of the creation. So that's all cut off from their vision. Okay? But I just wanted to point that out before we move on. Start that verse over again and read.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel,
mm-hmm.
and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
There was under his feet, they saw the Elohim of Israel, and it was under his feet a paved work of a sapphire stone. Now, when technology increased to the space race, we had the opportunity to get into rocket ships and take pictorial illustrations of this place that our physical bodies call home, the planet Earth. And when you get up there and you get out of the atmosphere, you get far enough away, it looks like a paved work of sapphire stone. And that was under his feet. So that's consistent with what we're talking about, or what is being said out here in Acts 7, 40-something and whatnot, where it says, heaven is his throne, and earth is his footstool. And we'll continue to read, but you got a question or comment there, Dr.
The only definition that I've heard or I understand is static is interference on a radio signal. What does static mean as it's applied to the chart?
Okay, so when I'm talking about static, if you ever have clothes you don't put in fabric softener in, as it sticks to the other thing, it's not moving. Static as in not, you can't just move things around on here. You know, we need a paintbrush or, you know, how they did in, or like, a slider or something like that. You know, it's static. You can't take this and pick it up and bring it down here. It's staying here because it's painted on the canvas right here. So that's what I mean by static. This pictorial illustration is static to where it's at. Unless you, you know,
during the
put some turpentine on it or something, and it'll come off.
Stationary.
Okay. Stationary. Is that?
Only little change.
Okay.
There's no movement like that static you're talking about with the radio.
Yeah.
There's interference.
Yeah.
Can we get the definition of static since and read the definition of static just for clarity? And while we get that, let's just continue reading about in 24:9.
Okay. I'll read 24. And
all right, he's got to get a mic.
So, now it's time. You want 24:9 out of Acts?
Acts. Exodus. Yeah.
Exodus 24:9.
Yes. Right.
Then went up Moses, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the 70 of the elders of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel.
Right.
And there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
Right. Read.
And as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness.
And as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness. Heaven being his throne, and earth being his footstool. And that's just a correlation, if you will, that you have Stephen correlating the same thing that Moses, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, the 70 elders, a.k.a. the fathers, saw. And we're talking about the fathers, and we're talking about this tabernacle that was given to them out here in the wilderness that they had. And he's talking about that Yahweh dwells not in temples made with hands. He doesn't dwell in this physical tabernacle. Now, we're going to read on a little bit. Skip down to 25:8.
25, Exodus 25:8.
Mm-hmm.
And let them make me a sanctuary.
This is that tabernacle that they were to build out there in the wilderness that the fathers had. Read.
That I may dwell among them.
That he may dwell among them. Now, it's not if they build it like Field of Dreams, he will come type of situation. This is a schoolmaster. So, Yahshua, the Messiah, who is the same as Yahshua or Joshua, the son of Nun, said, take on my yoke all that them that are laden and burdened and learn of me. So when you have, now skip on down to the last verse of 25 right there, the 25 of Exodus, 25 and 40.
And look that thou make them after the pattern.
Now you look. You look at this tabernacle. And you look that they make them, read.
Which were showed thee in the mount.
That you look. Read it again. I'm sorry. I messed you up.
And look that thou make them after their pattern.
Mm-hmm.
Which was shown thee in the mount.
Right. Now, it says, look, that them make them after the pattern. Everything. It's there somewhere. I might have missed it, but it's either back there in 25:8 or it's down there close to 40.
You
but everything. Yeah, go to 25:9 because everything is to be made after this pattern.
25:8. And let them make me a sanctuary.
Right.
That I may dwell among them.
Right.
According to all that I show thee.
Mm-hmm.
After the pattern of the tabernacle. And the pattern of all the instruments thereof. Even so shall ye make it.
See, everything is made after this pattern of the tabernacle right here. This is the schoolmaster, as I've already said. Now, he said, make them a sanctuary so that he may dwell among them. And I just made a reference. What was that? Matthew, where he says, learn of me?
Yeah.
Matthew 11 or something like that. Or
okay.
11 and 29, I believe. Is that what it is? I just
Matthew 11:29.
Mm-hmm.
Take my yoke upon you, mm-hmm. and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart,
right.
and ye shall find rest unto your souls.
Mm-hmm. Now, see, Yahshua.
For my yoke is easy, and right. my burden is light.
Mm-hmm. Now, Yahshua, when he's talking to Peter, give me the scripture when he's talking to Peter, and he says, show us the Father that it sufficeth us. Because I want you to know what you're doing when you're taking on his yoke. He's talking to Peter, and he says, show us the Father that it sufficeth us. Was he talking to Thomas? I don't got my phone on me. I can't. I feel naked. Yeah, I'll take it. Is it John 14? Sounds about right. Yep, John 14:8. Philip. Not Peter. Start with a P.
You want it read?
Yes, please.
John 14:8.
Mm-hmm.
Philip said unto him, Rabbi, show us the Father, and it suffices us. Should I go up further?
Yeah, keep on reading. Okay. He says, so he's talking to Yahshua the Messiah is talking to his disciples right here. And just pick it up a couple of verses to pick up the train of thought, just so that for the continuity.
5. Thomas said unto him, Rabbi, we know not whither thou goest, mm-hmm. and how can we know the way?
Right.
Yahshua said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life.
Right.
No man cometh unto the Father but by me. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. And from henceforth ye know him and have seen him.
So no man cometh unto the Father except by him. Now we got back here, and this is why I'm picking all of this up. Because we talk, Yahweh is declaring back in Exodus 25 to let them build him a sanctuary that he may dwell among them. Yahshua the Messiah over here in John the 14th chapter is saying that no man can come to the Father where the Father may dwell except they come by him. Now over in Matthew 11:29, he's saying, Yahshua the Messiah is saying, learn of him, of Yahshua. Okay? Now continue to read where we're at in John.
Yahshua said unto him.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, did I get Philip? Let me do 8. Philip said unto him, Rabbi, show us the Father, and it suffices us.
Mm-hmm.
Yahshua said unto him, have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that has seen me has seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, show us the Father?
You see, he said, have I been so long with you that you don't know who I am? When you see me, Yahshua the Messiah, you see the Father. Because we don't have a trinity. There's no such thing as a trinity when it comes to the Holy Spirit. There's trinities in, you know, organizations. There's you know, trinities when you in the Olympics, when you race. You got first, second, and third place. There's 3 different people all in the same race. But it's based on each one of them individual characters' ability to, which decides on where they wind up on that, in that ranking, that hierarchy of that so-called Trinity, if you will. But this is, we talking about our Heavenly Father is a unity. Mm-hmm. And who the world calls Jesus, was not Joseph and Mary's little boy. That was Yahweh, pure spirit, taking on shape and form in the womb of the Virgin Mary, Miriam, whatever, Magdalene. And, yeah, Miriam, I'm sorry. And the Spirit came to her and told her that she was with child. She hadn't been touched by nobody. She was a virgin. It wasn't her DNA that was coming up out of her. That was a specially prepared body. And the reason why that had to be a specially prepared body, because they had to have a specially prepared lamb down here. This body was prepared to be sacrificed for the transgressions of the Jews, because they were given this tabernacle that we're talking about over here in Acts, where they were to follow. They had a tabernacle and they had a law going along with this tabernacle, and if they could complete this entire law, this law in its entirety, then that would be unto their righteousness. And these Jews, because that law was given to the Jews and the Jews only. It wasn't given, we're not talking about the Gentiles. If they could complete that into their in its entirety, then that would be unto their righteousness. They could not. They made a covenant. The house of Israel made a covenant with Yahweh after he led them out of the land of Egypt. And they said that they would follow this law, and they could not do it. When they made this covenant, they became the bride. And since they could not do it, it necessitated the husbandman to come down in a specially prepared body, Yahshua the Messiah, and fulfill, complete that law that was given to those Jews. Yahshua said to Philip, when you see me, that is, when you see who he is, when you see him, when you see Yahshua for who he really is, which he just declared just a few verses ahead when he said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. When you see that and you understand it, when you have the knowledge, like was talked about in Ecclesiastes in our scripture lesson today, when you come to that knowledge of who Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua really is a unity. There is no, absolutely no separation at all between Yahweh Elohim, and Yahshua. When you see that that is the Father, that Yahshua is, when you see him, then you see that he is the Father. That's what he's saying there. And we have a pattern of this tabernacle to show you that, to show you how Yahweh, pure spirit, took on shape and form and manifest in a physical body. 1, 2, 3. The founder used to say, you don't got to have a PhD, a DD, or any all of them different things after your name in order to understand this thing. You don't have to have an education at all. He said he had a sixth grade education. He didn't have an education. He said he was a nobody. All you got to be able to understand is 1, 2, 3. Pure spirit. Inscrutable, the source of everything. Spirit taken on shape and form. In truth and righteousness. And that spirit of truth and righteousness being manifest in the flesh or out of the flesh. But when it's being made manifest, when it's being drawn out, that is Yahshua. Any confusion that you may have, any misunderstanding, any darkness that dwells in your heart and in your mind is not of the Father. And what we're doing down here is casting out that darkness. We're shedding light on our own ignorance. Yahweh is doing that through the preaching of this gospel, through the knowledge and understanding of this tabernacle. Let's go back over to Acts and read, because I wanted to get about this. I wanted to draw out what this tabernacle is about. I hope that something is making some sense about how important this is.
You want to start with
Acts, yeah,
49?
Back, yeah, wherever we were at with the tabernacle.
Heaven is my throne.
And earth is his footstool.
And earth is my footstool.
Mm-hmm. Read.
What house will ye build me, saith Yahweh?
What house? What church on the corner? We got churches on every corner. What house are you going to build for Yahweh? We got houses. We got church houses on every corner. And most of them, pastors, preachers, gurus, They ain't doing right. They taking the money and doing something. Oh, it'll be all right. I'll put it back next month if they get it, you know. And then sometimes they get caught. Oh, they take it from the cookie jar, or whatever, you know. Holding they back up high, all holy and pious, trying to hide something, look better than somebody else, trying to be like God. We already know that you can't be like God. You already are who you're looking for. Matter is spirit materialized. So you trying to be like God, you hiding something. You hiding your iniquity. Trying to be like the Most High. Humble yourself. You ain't no better than the next. Read.
What is the place of my rest? Has not my hand made all these things? Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Spirit, as your fathers did, so do ye.
Stiff-necked and uncircumcised. The circumcision being that cutting off of that flesh of the male foreskin. I don't want to get too detailed, but these uncircumcised, they can't cut off the flesh, because they look at this tabernacle and say that, oh, God is in this tabernacle, because they don't understand that this is a type and shadow showing forth the spirit principle, showing you how you are made in the likeness and image of Yahweh, using this tabernacle along with the law that was given, the statutes, judgments, and ordinances of the law, and then the creation, and looking and comparing it to the creation. Like we have the migratory pattern, how the Jews were cast down into bondage, evilly entreated, and had to be brought out by a mighty hand. This representing the outer court of the tabernacle, or the court round about, and then that dividing water representing that first compartmental veil. And then they cross over the divided waters of the Red Sea into the wilderness of Sinai. And this in the wilderness of Sinai representing the holy place, as Moses was instructed to take his shoes off of his feet when he came to the burning bush. He was out here in the wilderness at that time. This is described as that holy place. And then you've got a second compartmental veil in here that separates inside of this the tent of the tabernacle. You've got your first compartmental veil with your seven branch candle lampstand, your table of shewbread, and your altar of incense inside of that holy place. And then there's a second compartmental veil that separates the holy place from the most holy place. And on this migratory chart, you got this River Jordan as a separation between the wilderness of Sinai and that Canaan land. That Canaan land being the place that was promised to them, being the land flowing with milk and honey. When them spies, the members from each tribe of the children of Israel, the 12 tribes, 12 people went over here onto this into the Canaan land. They spied out the land, and they picked up fruit, and they was had big old large, like oversized, you know, miracle grow, beyond what miracle grow can give you. Fruits and vegetables, they coming back, they strapping grapes over their shoulders or what have you. It was a plentiful land over here, and this was the, and this land was what was promised to them, being like unto the most holy places. They was down here in famine and bondage and you know, Pharaoh, when they wanted to do anything that they wanted to do, Pharaoh said, oh, you want to go do something other than what I'm telling you to do? All right, well, we're going to take the mortar away from you, so you can make bricks without the mortar, making it harder on them. This is a hard place for them down here. This is an easy place up here. And that's just a correlation to the structure and function of this tabernacle being the most holy place. Divided by a holy place, divided by the court roundabout. But these three make up that one tabernacle. And these three geographic locations make up the one migratory trek of the children of Israel or the Jews. And they were given this law, and they were given this tabernacle, and they were to take this tabernacle with them wherever they went. And wherever they stopped, they were to put this tabernacle together, and they had a high priest and two low priests that officiated in this tabernacle. And whenever, and they had this law of 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances that were given to them in the mount. And whenever they transgressed or broke one of these laws, statutes, judgments, and ordinances, they had to take out a sacrifice. And they had to offer that sacrifice up to the priest to make an atonement for the sin, for the transgression of their law. And each and every one of them at one point in time or another had to do that. All the way down unto Yahshua the Messiah being raised up. And Yahshua, being that specially prepared body, he was created in the likeness of sinful flesh. But he had no sin. No man could find any sin in him. Now, this law was given to them, and none of them could keep the law. But this specially prepared body, Yahshua the Messiah, or Yahshua, we don't want to get confused and start saying the Messiah is like his last name or anything like that. Yahshua was his name. Yahshua, meaning Yahweh, the contracted form of Yahweh, is salvation or the deliverer. Yahweh will deliver us. And like he just said over to Philip, he said, have I been so long with you that you don't know who I am? Hey, my name is Yahshua. You know, when you see me, when you actually see me, when you understand the structure and function of this tabernacle pattern and how it correlates with spirit law, then you see the Father in him, because he didn't have any sin. And this was the husbandman that I was just saying that came down. This was Yahweh who made the covenant with the Jews and the Jews only, coming down, making that car payment, paying off that car note so that they can have that promise of salvation, so that they can learn something of Yahweh, so that they can know him. Like the founder would say, you have to come to a profound knowledge and understanding. It's over in Thessalonians. I always get it all the time. 5:21. You prove all things and hold fast that which is good. Why are we doing that? Because we got that old boy, Satan, the devil, the dragon, the mystery of iniquity, that mystery that is not equal with what is true, what is righteous, that is dwelling in darkness. And Yahshua is the light that shines in that darkness, and that darkness comprehends it. Not. It doesn't comprehend it. I was finish that sentence. That darkness does not comprehend that light. The light is there. Now he's talking about Yahweh dwelling not in temples made with hands. Now we're talking about that old boy, the devil. Revelations 12 and 10. Please. We point out that old boy because, see, we learn why we got to learn something about Yahshua. Why do we have to learn something about Yahshua, our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah? Why do we have to learn something? What if we are Yahweh being manifest? Why don't we know already?
Messiah means sender. They send
him. Mm-hmm.
Messiah means sender.
Messiah
Yeah,
let's go ahead and get the definition so we can get a because this is a school. Let's get the definition of Messiah. We can have a clear elucidation and understanding of what that word Messiah means. So we're talking about Yahshua is not his last name and things like Yahshua is the Messiah. But let's go ahead and get that. We get it out of Miriam if we can or whatever. We can get it out of blue letter. It doesn't matter to me.
Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
The expected king or deliverer of the Jews.
Okay. Got some more? We got the root of it. We can get back down to the etymology of it.
A professed or accepted leader of some hope or cause.
Mm-hmm.
Anointed. Hebrew and Aramaic. Literally anointed.
Anointed.
Mm-hmm.
And we understand that an anointing being the quickening. And a high priest had to have that anointing. Anybody who came into this tabernacle, who passed out of this court roundabout, who would go into that holy place, had to have that anointing first. That anointing is a likening of a quickening. Mm-hmm. Having, so when you, that mystery of iniquity dwells in death. He doesn't have spirit. I was just talking about the darkness. Let's go over here to this chart. We talk about this darkness and this father of lies, this misunderstanding, this mystery of iniquity dwells in darkness. I just had over there in Revelations 12 and 10. Let's get that.
12 and 8?
No. Mm-hmm.
And the great dragon cast out.
That dragon was cast out. Read.
That old serpent called the devil and Satan.
That devil, Satan, he was cast out of heaven. We talked about heaven is Yahweh's throne, right? Mm-hmm. We just read that. And earth is his footstool.
Right.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, Yahweh dwelleth not in temples made with hands, right? We talked about that. Okay, now let's read about this old boy, the devil.
Which deceiveth the whole world.
He deceiveth the whole world. He deceiveth the whole age. He deceived all. People don't like it when I say it. He deceived all of them angels. Those angels being creatures. Now go over in John. Because those angels were created out of Yahweh. Pure spirit. When he take on shape and form, and then he gave it Romans 8 and the creation travaileth 8 and Romans first before we go over in John 1 and 4. Romans 8 and the creation travaileth and groaneth in pain, groaneth and travaileth in pain. Is Romans 8 and something.
23, 20, well.
The whole creation.
Yeah. For we know that...
It's right up at the top of the page with the Holy Name Bible.
I'm trying to decide which one is good. Okay, let's go 22.
Okay.
For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now.
The whole creation. Now, let's, before we move on, we're talking about the creation. We're talking about the physical and the angelic. Because the angelic, we just can't say that the angelic is not part of the creation, or it wouldn't be on this chart right here, part of the creation. It is part of the whole creation. All of it groaneth and travaileth in pain right now. There's another part in the scriptures where it says even the angels want to look into some of the things that we in our physical bodies are experiencing. They want to look. This whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain. We just read over in Revelations that devil deceiveth the whole world.
Right.
Now we talking about that devil, and now let's go over back into John 1 and 4. Let's talk about this darkness. Because we want to know why we got to learn something about Yahshua. What's taking place? What's in our way? What is in the way of our knowledge and understanding? Let's get that bad boy out there so we can move him out of the way. If Yahweh willing.
That's right.
Read.
In him was life, and the light was the light
of
one. Men.
I'm sorry.
Pardon me?
Just start at one.
One?
Yeah.
In the beginning was the Word.
In the beginning of the creation was the Word. That Word being Yahweh in pure spirit, taking on shape and form as Yahweh Elohim. The Word or Son. Over we got on the name chart, the Word or Son. In the beginning of the creation, before there was a physical creation, when there was an angelic creation, there was a beginning of this creation. And in that beginning was the Word. Read.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
And that Word was with Yahweh. Read.
And the Word was Yahweh.
And the Word was Yahweh. Read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh. All things were made by him.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh. And the same was right now. The same that was in the beginning is the same as right now. You understand that? That's why we got that tabernacle that the fathers had.
No different.
It's the same thing. If you understand the principle. And the only way to get to the Father is through the Son. And the Son came walking the earth plane for 33 and a half years. 3.5 of those years fulfilling. Go ahead and continue reading there in John.
In him was life, and the life was the light of men.
In the Word that was with Yahweh, that was Yahweh, was life. What do we have? What do we claim that we walking around the earth, we breathe in, we move it around, we procreate and making babies and so on and so forth, and, you know, gaining riches or living in poverty, whatever, however we want to live. We think that this is our life. We call it, this is my life.
Yeah.
And the Word was life. Read.
And the life was the light of men.
And that life was the light of man. Okay? That's important. That's the light of man. We are mankind. Male and female created he him. In the sixth day when mankind was created. He was created male and female. Hermaphroditic, if you will. He had to be that way to show back forth to the masculine and feminine all-encompassing state of our Heavenly Father. He doesn't need to go out with outside of himself to create anything. Man being made in the likeness and image of Yahweh had to be created the same way. We just read that Yahweh dwells not in temples made with hands.
Right.
That first man, Adam, was not made with hands.
Right.
And he is made in the likeness and image of that tabernacle is in the made in the likeness and image of Yahshua. It's a schoolmaster, it's a ruler to show you how you point back up to the Father so that you can learn of him. So you can learn of the Father. Yahshua said, learn of me. And then he all went on and said, I am the Father. No Trinity. It's all the same thing. You just got to get out of the flesh. You have to be able to turn your neck. In this most holy place, you have a tabernacle, an Ark of the Covenant that's got staves on it, and it's on a swivel, and it ain't stiff. You stiff neck, you can't turn this way, you can't look that way, you can't see the pattern happening over here, you can't see the pattern happening over here, you can't see the pattern happening over here, you can't see the pattern happening over here because you're stiff neck, you're looking at the flesh. Cut off that foreskin, cut off that flesh, become circumcised in your heart and your mind, let go of your own theories, concepts, and opinions, and ideas of what you think, and accept the truth. Read the light of all men. That the word was the light of all men.
In him was life, and the life was the light of men.
Mm-hmm.
And the light shineth in darkness, and
now
the
that
darkness
light,
comprehended it not.
That light, I love it. That light, which is Yahweh Elohim, it shineth in the darkness, mm-hmm. and the darkness comprehended it not. Is that what it says?
Right.
Read it again. Just make sure. We just want to make sure that's what it says.
And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
I wish that we could get the definition, the scientific definition, and read about the difference between the description of what light is and what darkness is.
Knowledge and understanding.
Mm-hmm.
The light.
Knowledge and understanding is the light. You are very correct. Ignorance is the darkness. But on a scientific level, just when we're talking about the electrical charge, what it may be that causes the illumination of things.
The positive.
Yeah. Like there's, see, white, or let's do white and black. Let's do white and black. That's the definition between white and black. I got a workout detector. I'm getting my steps in. Smartwatch.
Light is something that Yahweh created,
mm-hmm.
and darkness is the absence of light.
When you don't have
light, you have darkness. But darkness isn't something.
You light, started with that, too.
Light is something. It travels.
Mm-hmm.
You could take it with you.
Yes.
But darkness is just there when the light is not.
Darkness is nothing. Okay. And so she's saying it. If we can't find it, that's fine. You can look it up on your own. She said it. Light is the presence. White, if you will, is the presence of light. Black or darkness is the absence of light. Okay? Now, we're reading over here in John where that light shineth in that darkness, in that dark state. And that darkness, that absence of light, which was described as the absence of the Word, which was the light of all men. See, that Word shines in the darkness up here. That darkness doesn't comprehend it. The founder said it like this. When you come down here to this school for the first time, you are DOA. Dead on arrival. Because you know not anything of your Heavenly Father for who He is and how He actually exists. Now, you walking around, Will like to say all the time, dead man walking like you're the Green Mile. Yeah. Not 8 Mile, that's Eminem. When you're on death row and they go and they're getting ready to take you to the executioner's booth, whatever way that they're going to do it, the gallows or what have you, they say, dead man walking. When you come up into this school for the first time, you ain't never been down here before. You don't know nothing about the true nature of our Heavenly Father, the supernal nature of our Heavenly Father. You are absolutely dead on arrival. And when you come down here, as I stated, you sit in this classroom, in one of these classrooms, and you listen to the gospel of Yahshua being preached in truth, and you accept that truth. You investigate the things that are being told. You line them up to that tabernacle that was given to their fathers back there, and you can come out of that darkness and be in heaven on earth, right here in your seat. It's the 10th aim of this school, is to inherit eternal life now. Not after we die, as they try to get you to believe in Christendom. You know, you're gonna die, and then you're gonna walk up to a pearly gate with gold trim all around it, because it's got to be something physical. It's got to be some, even though it's spiritual, it's got to be something physical, because you can't get past the flesh. Because they stiff-necked and uncircumcised. And we're talking about over here in Acts. And we're getting back over into Acts. Because, see, this is what I'm talking about, this tabernacle. And we correlate in what Stephen is talking about, what the fathers have. And they're persecuting him right now. He getting ready to get stoned right now. And he landed out there on the line. He ain't taking those. What the founder said, hew to the line and let the chips fall where they may. Everything that man said, he said it for a reason. He got up on the floor. He said, I'm choosing my words. I'm not wasting no words. He used to say it all the time.
You sure did.
I'm hard pressed to not waste any words. I do the best I can, but you know, I hear people who were under the voice of the founder of this school declaring that what was being said by him is too esoteric to be understood. I'm listening to the recordings and I understand it, but see, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with Yahweh. And the Word was Yahweh. And the same was with Yahweh in the beginning. And that Word was the light that lighteth all men. And that light shineth in that darkness. And that darkness comprehendeth it not.
Right.
If you can understand that, you can understand what Yahshua was saying when he was talking to Philip. When he said, when you see me, you see the Father. Because it's not a literal thing. It's a type and shadow. It's allegory. We speaking in allegories. We got charts all around. We got plates and charts all around this room. And they all saying the same thing. There are some of us that have been in very studious in this institute and have devoted their a huge portion of their life to studying these scriptures and learning these things and getting them down and understanding them. And they can run these charts, one here, one there, over and you know, on whatever chart that you put in front of them. They can explain what it's about in detail. And that's good. That don't make them any better than somebody who can just get up here and just say, most holy place, holy place, court roundabout. You know, Yahweh, Elohim, Yahshua. Inscrutable, incorporeal, concrete. Thank you. Inscrutable, incorporeal, concrete. You know, I was looking at, I enjoyed class on Tuesday. I really did enjoy going through that transcript. I thought it was a very relevant transcript for us to go through, considering, you know, the topics that we've been discussing for the last couple of months. And I think that, you know, the reading of that transcript ought to have put to rest any confusion that we may have about what age we're in.
Yeah.
And I was reflecting to Ontario and the changes that have taken place in this branch school over the last couple of years after Tuesday night's class. And I started to text our dean, and I had wrote a paragraph or two, and I didn't end up sending it because I knew I was just going to get into a long, long conversation, and I had a lot of things to do, and I figured I could table that until today, either before or after class. But I was thinking about it, and you know how when, like, us, our branch has fought to have a place to learn something about what thus saith Yahweh. Mm-hmm. And when we fought to stay still and what I mean by stay still, just stay in this build, not change, not leave out and go and start a new thing, because there's no reason to really start a new thing. If you understand what we just talked about in John, the first chapter, and that, you know, that word being the same all the way down, it don't matter where you go. You can open up a school over here, a school over there. Dr. Kinley said it this said in the ministers' meeting in 1958, before the first class in Los Angeles. He said that there can be nothing in LA where they're setting up that's not in Springfield, Ohio. And there can be nothing in Springfield, Ohio, that's not here in L.A. There's nothing here in pure spirit that's not here. There's nothing here in the incorporeal that is not here in the corporeal. There's nothing here in IDMR that is not out in the world. The difference is, and this is the way the founder said it, he said, I am Yahweh. Mm-hmm. You are too. I know and understand it. You don't.
Right.
Just because the church and Christendom and all of that, they don't know and they don't understand, they don't have all of this teaching and whatnot, they believe what they want, it doesn't make it any different. No. They just don't understand it. They got it all mixed up. It's just all mixed up. It's abstract. They don't got it right. They don't got it. They're not using this that the fathers had. But that light shineth in the darkness. And that light is the light of all men. We come in here in darkness. There ain't nothing different. Except for your knowledge and understanding. You don't have no understanding. You lusting after the flesh. You worried about where your next meal going to come from. How you going to come up, get that next promotion. When you going to retire, what's in your 401k. You ought to be learning a hymn. These Jews, they are so dang on miserable out here. Yahweh outpoured 10 great miracles and overthrew those Egyptians and brought those Jews up out of that land of Egypt, and they're still out here bellyaching. Why you do this to us? Why you do this to us? Can I have this? Can I have that? They just didn't understand. They just didn't have the understanding. We're over there in Romans where we were at, and the whole creation travaileth in pain till now. We can explain with that why they was weeping and all of that right there. Go ahead. Let's get it if we can. Got a little bit of time.
For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together unto mm-hmm. now.
In pain. Pain is not a happy place. Read. Mm-hmm.
And not only they, but ourselves also.
We too. Read.
Which have the first fruits of the Spirit. Even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for
the
adoption.
See, they got the first fruits. See, over here, they reading, they talking about these Jews. They got the first fruits. They got that outpouring of the Holy Spirit on that day of Pentecost. He's not talking to the Gentiles right there, right then and now. But he talking about here, they got the first fruits. They groaning and faileth and in pain too. And they got the Holy Spirit outpouring. They know something about this tabernacle. They know something about Yahshua. They walked around. They were disciples. They walked around. They learned to him. And they groaning and travaileth and in pain. The whole creation. Nobody's escaping it. I got ailments. You come up here and tell me you ain't got nothing wrong with you and your life is perfect. Ain't nothing ever happening to you. If you walk up in this classroom, I know you got a date with death. You got a date.
Yep.
So the pain ain't over with. Mm-mm. Read, please.
Let's see where we did stop. Even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope. But hope that is seen is not hope.
We have hope. We have hope. And this is a hope. You can see something about this. But this ain't going to save you. It's Yahshua that's going to save you. The truth that's going to save you. You can't see that with your physical eyes. We talk about what Yahweh is made up of when he takes on shape and form. Those spiritual attributes of intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength wrapped up in kingdom. And we talk about how you can't grasp, you can't just control these attributes. You can't see them. You can't put them in a jar and put them on sale. You just can't do it. You hope for these things. You hope not to have a dang on stroke and not remember what you knew yesterday. If that's plain enough English for you. We hope. For eternal life. We hope. We ain't, you can't grab it. Not can't none of us. Not one of us just grab it and hold on and say, I got it and know it. Unless you have Yahshua. Dwelling in you, in your heart and mind. And let me tell you what the Holy Spirit is. The Holy Spirit is love, of the brethren. Now, you claim you got eternal life. You got that Holy Spirit, and it's people groaning and travailing in pain, then you ought to be doing some labor. Get up on the cross. Die. What did he say? If anybody come back to him, take up his cross. Then they say anybody want to come up after him? Mm-hmm. Do what he did? Because mm-hmm. It ain't no different. 1, 2, 3. Go ahead, read, please.
For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for?
Mm-hmm. You can't see it. You can't see it. You can perceive it, but you can't just see it in concrete. Not like that. We got these charts to get you an understanding and elucidation. But see, Romans 1:19-20. Please.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh.
Because that manifest. Now we talking about learning. Yahshua said, "Learn of me," and he said, "When you see me, you see the Father." And he said, well, that's what, so when you see Yahshua, you see the Father because Yahshua is the Father. Now he said, because that which may be known of Yahweh, which is Yahshua, read.
Is manifest in them.
It's manifest in you how? Please read.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
Yahweh showed it unto you. How did he show it to you? By way of this tabernacle pattern. By the preaching of the death, the burial, and the resurrection. Through the foolishness of preaching. For the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah. By the preaching of the gospel. Yahweh showing something so that you can know something about him. Matthew 5:39 says, ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, but they are they which testify of me. The scriptures is everything that's talking about this tabernacle. The law and the prophets. He said he was. He said, you see me, you see the Father. He said, when you looking about the scriptures, that's testifying to him. Put it together. Make the correlations. Read, please.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world.
We're just talking about hope. And hope being seen, right? What? The invisible things. We hoping for something invisible. We knowing something about Yahweh in his invisible state. Read.
From the creation of the world are clearly seen.
From the creation, from this invisible angelic creation, the beginning of this creation, from the invisible things of the creation of the world are clearly seen. Read.
Being understood by the things that are made.
You can understand them by the things, the physical things, the physical things, the physical things, the physical things that are made. Read.
Even his eternal power and supernal nature.
Even his eternal power. The power of transmutation to come out of that pure spirit, inscrutable state, take on shape and form, and then put on a physical body and walk around in the earth plane, and you not know it. Read, do we got any more?
Even his supernal nature, eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
So that they are without excuse. All right, let's get back over into Acts. There's no excuse. There's no excuse when you search the scriptures and realize that they are they which testify of the Son and the Son. This is important. Points to the Father. Read.
7:52. Mm-hmm. Which of the apostles have not your fathers persecuted? And they have slain them which showed before of the coming of the just one, of whom ye have been now the betrayers and murderers.
They murdering them. Read. Just read.
Who have received the law by the disposition of angels, mm-hmm, and have not kept it.
They received that law and they didn't keep that law. Angels are ministering spirits. Yahweh being spirit and life. And Yahweh being a spirit of truth. That law being the truth. And they received that truth and they didn't keep it. They turned away from that truth. And that likens them unto that third of the innumerable company of angels that followed that tail of that devil. We didn't get that far over in Revelations, but it's there. Read.
When they heard these things, they were cut to the heart.
They was cut to the heart because they was like, man, we can't do nothing with that. It's there in the scriptures, what he's saying. We restoring these carnal ordinances because we don't believe. This is what they did, these Pharisees and scribes and whatnot, those persecuting Stephen out here. Got the rock throwed up. About to knock him out. They up here. They trying to restore all of these. They don't believe that Yahshua was Yahweh manifest, that he died, and that law, he took that law out of the way. That Matthew 5:17, is that what it is? Or John 5:17, think not that I am come to destroy. Mm-hmm. Yeah. See, he didn't come to destroy the law, but he came to fulfill that law. He came to complete that law. And those scribes and those Pharisees and what had you, they didn't believe that that's what that was accomplished. Because they didn't know. They didn't have that understanding. They didn't have the knowledge. They didn't have the understanding. So they out here, he up here, they preaching that, you know, no, we ain't no need to be getting water baptized anymore. Don't do it. You baptizing in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. The anointed. What I found out about, I looked up olive oil on Tuesday night after class, because what I have recognized is when we decided to stay here and continue to preach the gospel the way that we have, mm-hmm. not let nobody move us left and right because of what's being said over there. I'm not worried about what they're saying over there. What I'm worried about, what thus saith Yahweh. That's the reason why we stayed here. There's people out there know where these doors are at. They can come on in and they can learn. But we ain't got too many up in here. But that's fine. We got a YouTube channel we people can look at, whatnot, you know. Viewership's down a little bit. That's fine. I don't care. You know, I would love to have all of those that come, you know, that were here in the past, come back and sup with the brethren and, you know, support us. Because all we're endeavoring to do down here, all we've endeavored, all Dr. Marlon Love, all Dr. Eunice Reiser, all Dr. Bud Wunsch, all myself, Aaron Alanese, Maria Clemens, Nanette Ramirez, all Dr. Samuel Silas, welcome back. We're so glad to have you back. All we've been endeavoring to do is preach what thus saith Yahweh for somebody to understand, to somebody to come and know, have a better, more profound knowledge and understanding of who our Heavenly Father is and how he actually exists. And us that are still remaining here, we realize it doesn't matter where you at. Doesn't matter if you over there. We don't need to go no place else. Because if in fact, when we go someplace else, the same pitfalls, the same snares, the same obstacles that we have here are going to occur over there. And this is already an established 501(c) organization. There was a dean by the name of Dr. Burbank Mitchell. And it was a time where he seen some things that were going on in the institute. And I was told this story by another dean. He seen some things that were going on in the institute that he didn't like. He didn't agree with it. He wanted it to stop. He tried to get it to stop. And it just wasn't stopping from happening. And he approached the founder and asked him, hey, I don't want to deal with these people anymore. I'd like to start up another school, another institute that so we can separate from these folks that are doing the things that they ought not to be doing. Dr. Kinley told Burbank Mitchell, what you want to go and do that for? You got a perfectly good school right here. It don't matter. See, he also said that both mysteries were being raised up right here in these seats. You gonna run from it? It's gonna both mysteries. You can't get away from it. It don't matter where you go. You can run, but you can't hide. Sure. Now, when we were separated and, you know, and the pandemic came and, you know, our attendance went down and memberships went down and, you know, some of our members left from us. We were hard pressed to preach this gospel. Now, I told you I looked up olive oil. Now, there's only two ingredients that you need to make olive oil, and that is olives and water. And you take those olives and you pit the olives. You take the seeds out of the olives And then when you get the pit out of the olives, you mash up them olives real light. You put them in, you can put them in a blender. They had their own devices back, you know, back in the day to do what they did. But you mash them up real good. You get them ground up until it's like a brown mush. And then you take something like a cheesecloth or something to strain it. Mm-hmm. And you take that and you fold it up and you press that mush. Mm-hmm. And you press out all of that oil and that water out of that flesh. You got blood, water, and spirit right there making olive oil. And you press and you separate that flesh from that blood and that water. And then you let it rest. It rests. And when it rests, that water and that oil separates. Okay. And then you scoop that oil out. For it's beautiful. It's a beautiful thing. You know, Adam's apple. Adam's olive, yeah. We're about out of time, but I thank you for your testimony, Dr. Clemens, because Yahweh, he did form the light. He took on shape and form, and he formed the light, and he created the darkness. And that light shineth in that darkness, and that darkness comprehended it not. And that flesh that needs to be it needs to be cut off. That circumcision is an act of cutting off that flesh. And that's a type and shadow of us cutting off our theories, concepts, and opinions and what we think we know and coming to a true knowledge and understanding, accepting the truth that this Yahshua the Messiah is Yahweh being made manifest. And when he died, buried, and resurrected, 50 days later, he outpoured his Holy Spirit first to the Jews, and then 7 years later to the Gentiles. And through a knowledge and understanding, which is bestowed upon us by grace, can't work up on it. Don't get it twisted. According to this pattern, you can come up out of that darkness into the light right here on your seat and have the illumination of the fact that you are who you're looking for. The source of the life that lights your physical tabernacle that is made without man's hands is our Heavenly Father. Yes.
You know, 2 Peter, 3rd chapter read.
Go ahead. I don't know if we got the time or not. But
just read it straight through.
We're going to make the time. 2 Peter what? 3rd chapter.
No, from 7.
I hope y'all listening, kids.
From 7.
I'm teaching y'all.
7.
And then down to 13.
Okay. 2 Peter 3:7. But the heavens and the earth, which are now by this same word are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of wicked men.
That word being Yahweh Elohim. Mm-hmm. Read.
But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with Yahweh as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. Mm-hmm. Yahweh
talking
is not
prophetic time. Read.
Yahweh is not slack concerning his promise.
He promised the Jews that Canaan land in a physical sense, and they got there, didn't they? He promised them if they could complete this law in its entirety, that would be unto their righteousness. Now they still waiting for it to happen. They still out here sacrifice. They still baptizing. They still having the Passovers. They still trying to follow the Ten Commandments and having all these ceremonies. They don't think the promise came. They want to say Jesus was their Savior, but they don't believe it because they still doing this. And that shows that they don't believe it. Read.
Yahweh is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of Yahweh will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise.
He won't come as a thief. You will think you're comfortable. You think you all got this down. I know the names. Yeah. I'm over here. I'm already here. I got it. Yahshua suffered, and he suffered until he got up on that cross and he died. Read.
And the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. The earth also and the works that are therein shall mm-hmm. be burned up.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conduct and righteousness? Looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of Yahweh, wherein the heavens being...
We're looking for it. That's that hope. The hope that's not seen. We're looking for it. Read.
And hasting unto the coming of the day of Yahweh, mm-hmm. wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat.
Mm-hmm.
Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness.
Mm-hmm. That's it. If anything was got and understood out of what was said today, all praises be to Yahweh Elohim through his only begotten son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah. So that will conclude today's class. Thank you. Hallelujah. That will conclude today's class. We don't have any announcements. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truthfully the place to learn something truthful of your Heavenly Father Yahweh. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say hallelujah.